Hello everyone, my name is Saokosal. Today we're gonna learn another new design pattern called factory. There are two types of factory: factory method and abstract factory. Okay, let's go into it. In this tutorial, I will explain what is factory method in Java with examples. Even though it is in Java, you can apply this technique in your programming language. Before I go on, let me remind you that you should watch until the end of this video. Plus, you should write the code that I am about to show you in this video. I think that is the only way to improve your programming skill. So if you complete your code, please comment down below and say that I wrote the code. And if you have any question or problem, you can ask me in the comment section down below as well. If you are new, I would like to invite you to subscribe to my channel and click on the notification bell next to it so that in the future you won't miss any tutorial. Now, what is the factory method? By the definition, the factory method defines an interface for creating an object and lets subclasses decide which class to instantiate. You might not get what it means by now, but that's okay. That's why I created this video tutorial just to explain it. Okay, you know what a factory is, right? A factory of shoes, for example. If you place an inquiry to a factory of shoes, then you will get a catalog of shoes that the factory can produce. Maybe there are three types of shoes that the factory can make. What if you order a shirt from the factory of shoes? Will the factory produce the shirt for you? Absolutely not, because the factory is specialized in making good shoes, only shoes. Do you get what I mean? So that factory is the factory method. The factory method will let you place an order into the shoes factory so that you get a shoes object back. But the shoes object must be the one of those in the catalog that the factory can make. If you order any other product object beside the list, then you won't get any. In fact, you may get null pointer exception. Let's go back to the definition. Factory method defines an interface. Let's cut this part. The interface here means that you will not be allowed to order directly to a shoe staff to make a pair of high heels for you. You must place the order just right at the factory receptionist. That is the meaning of the interface. The factory method won't let you order parts directly to any of its core. Okay, let's go on with the definition. The factory method is an interface for creating an object, this part you already know, and let subclasses decide which class to instantiate. So, a receptionist or a front desk receives your order of maybe 100 pairs of high heel, then he decides, okay, which department is producing the high heels? Department A, for example. Okay, let's the Department A produces the high heel for the client. That is the meaning of the definition. Okay, let's see an example. First, I will create a parent class called ShoesType. You will declare it as an abstract class because you want its subclasses implement its abstract method. If you don't know what is the abstract class, you can watch another tutorial of mine about the top 10 facts you should know about abstract class in Java. I will put a link in the description down below. For the simplicity, I will create only one method, which is the abstract method. The abstract method is about money, so I will call it getPrice. The reason that we need to declare getPrice method as an abstract method is because there are three types of shoes, remember? Each shoes type has different price. Here we are not talking about color, shape, or style. that will lead to another pattern called abstract factory, which is a bit more complex, but we will learn about it in the next tutorial. Now assume we have only price to take care of. You might argue that we can use interface for this matter. Well, you can do that. In fact, interface can be more suitable for this situation. So either way is fine. We will create three subclasses, boot, flip-flop, and high heel. All will inherit from the shoes type. In Java, you can use extend keyword for inheritance. Because the shoe types has one abstract method, all three of its subclasses must implement each individual price. So boot type is $20, flip-flop is $5, and high heel is $40. Now, how to use those subclasses, the boot, the flip-flop, and the high heel, you might ask? Well, remember the definition? You won't allow anyone call directly to those subclasses, okay? That is the most important part. We will let the client to order to our factory receptionist first, and then the factory will decide to respond to the request. So here we need another class. That class is the factory method class. Okay, are you ready? Let's create a new class and call it shoes factory. In the shoes factory, we need one method to receive a request from a client. The method is the factory method. Some people prefer the method to be static so that it is easy to use, while some prefer a non-static method. In this example, I will use static for the factory method. Remember, design pattern is so named because it is just a pattern. Design pattern won't restrict you from writing different code. Now, the method return type. Remember, you want to respond to a client request of creating an object for him. So, the return type here is the response. What type should it be? Well, it is the shoe type. Because whatever the client wants, it must be in the catalog of the shoes type. The parameter of the method will be a type of shoes, the boot, the flip-flop, and the heel. A client cannot order any type beside the three types of shoes. You can use a simple string or final integer to represent a type, but in Java you can use enum, which lets you select a type without any typo. But if you write this code that does not support enum, you can always use a plain simple string or a constant variable. So if you get the type request, what you have to do is just test it out. Does it match to our type? Just by using if and else if. If it matches, then return a correct object. That's it. Remember, each type has its own price. So after you get the object, you will get its price. And then you can do whatever you want with the price. You might ask, what is the whole point of it? Why we have to write this complicated thing? Why not just call whatever class you want? Remember the rule of OOP? Encapsulation, reusability, flexibility, loosely coupled. Here we want to encapsulate the whole shoes process in one class. We don't want to show how we create shoes in our factory. Imagine you connect to Facebook APIs. Do you think Facebook will allow you to call anything you want? Of course not. You can use whatever they want you to use in a restriction area. Facebook encapsulates its own core. You can call to a particular class, in this case factory method class, then the class will handle the last bit for you. You will get an object if they allow. What is the reusability here? Well, in the future, you can always create a new type of shoes. A client will be able to request an available pair of shoes from your catalog. The shoe type will be reused over and over again. The flexibility is obvious, As you can see, the factory can allow you to use or restrict you from requesting any product. Just like Facebook can grant a permission or revoke a permission for using its API. Okay, let me summarize it. In the factory method, you will create a parent class which will act as a production of your factory. It can be an abstract class or interface, either way is fine. And then let its subclasses implement its different code. Next, you will need a factory class and a factory method that can test which request is to get which object from a client call. That's it for this video. I hope you like it. If you think this video is very useful, please hit the like button. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel, and I will see you in the next video.